This is Fragmented, an Android developer podcast where we talk about building good software and becoming better Android developers. I'm Don Felker.
And I'm Kaushik Gopal.
Welcome to the show. Before we hop into the guts of today's show, I want to thank today's sponsor, The Nerdery. Now, if you haven't heard of The Nerdery is a custom software design and development company built upon the belief that passionate nerds are the driving force behind business breakthroughs. And I would kind of have to agree with that. The Nerdery's vision is to be the best place in the world for nerds to work. Now, here's the thing. I actually know of The Nerdery folks far before Fragmented ever existed. A few years back, probably 4 or 5, I used to live in Minneapolis, and The Nerdery is headquartered there, and I used to run a user group up in the area. And a lot of The Nerdery's staff would come speak at my user group. They were very talented. I enjoyed hanging out with them because they were funny, great bunch of characters, and they had a nice office. But I guess that really didn't matter to me. But it should matter to you, because The Nerdery is hiring, and they're looking for nerds to join the nearly 500 different software engineers, UX designers, QA engineers, and other folks to help redefine what's possible through technology. Now, they're headquartered in Minneapolis, like I said, but they also have other offices in Chicago, Kansas City, and Phoenix. So if you're interested or you're looking for a job, go ahead and check out Nerdery's jobs, and that's going to be at nerderyjobs.com/fragmented. But wait, the URL is spelled a little bit differently. There's no E's in the word nerdery. That's nrdryjobs.com/fragmented. Don't worry about it. If you can't write it down because you're driving, I don't want you to crash. It's not a good deal there. If you're washing your dishes, I don't want you to put a knife through your hand. That's kind of a bad situation there too. Just go ahead and open up that little notes tab on your phone and just tap that little link that's in the show notes, or you can visit the website Fragmented Podcast and it'll be in the show notes there. And that's nerderyjobs.com/fragmented. Just let them know that the fine folks over here at Fragmented sent you over. Good luck. Thanks again, Nerdery. So, what's going on, Kaushik?
Nothing much. Google I/O is fast approaching, so that's good news for all of us.
I was wondering about that. I was looking at the map for that, and it looks like a lot of it's outside. Is that true? Do you know?
I'm not too sure. All I do know is I'm terribly disappointed that they moved it back to Mountain View now, just the year that I decided to move to San Francisco. So,
from Mountain View.
Yes. Yes, from Mountain View. So, speaking about which, I'm actually excited about our guest today. He's a super cool person. I met him in our previous Google I/O.
Yeah.
We also happened to meet him mutually in DroidCon NYC.
That was a good time.
We are extremely excited to have Elliot with us. Welcome to the show, Elliot.
Thank you very much, guys. I'm glad to be here.
Elliot, for the listeners who may not know you or are familiar with her, can you kind of give us a little bit, full name, background, kind of where you're working at now, what you've been up to, how you got into Android development, just so people have a little bit of background about you?
Yeah, for sure. So my name is Elliot Schenger. I'm an Android developer at Under Armour right now, Connected Fitness in Austin, Texas. And I've been doing Android for about 5 years now. I actually got started with it while I was in school. It was something that I was really kind of passionate about, finding something new to play with and be able to kind of work with, to kind of get some chops ready for the working world, and realized quickly that if I was going to develop for iOS, I needed to have some money. And as a broke college student, that was not necessarily something that I had a lot of. So it happened that I had an awesome Android phone. So I was like, might as well try learning Android, and kind of got started from there. And the last place I worked at was a company called Mutual Mobile, which also is in Austin, Texas, and kind of a digital product company for service. And it was great. You know, I loved getting to see a bunch of different companies and work on a bunch of different stuff and just enjoy the platform and kind of experience more and more of it. So that's kind of my background. And I ended up moving to Under Armour because I'm really passionate about wearables. And I don't know if you guys heard, but we've had this thing called the Health Box that just released. And that's kind of our toe in the water for getting into wearables.
Nice. Yeah. I mean, Under Armour has been kicking butt. I noticed that new device that you folks released. And also, obviously, you guys have Stephen Curry now. So that also is a big thing for us folks here in the Bay.
Yeah, we're pretty excited about him as well. It's been really awesome to see the brand flourish, but as well have like athletes that are doing so well. And that's pretty awesome.
So today, actually, what we wanted to talk about is one of the topics that Elliot talked about at DroidCon NYC, and it's essentially text views. So text views are super interesting. It's actually pretty deceptive because it seems like a very simple sort of concept and a very simple widget, but there's a lot of fun stuff happening with text views. And we thought, given that Elliot knows a thing or two about text views, we thought let's just dive in straight up with him.
Definitely. It's funny that we were talking about this, because I think it was last year sometime that I was just thinking about using text views and some screencasts that I was doing to explain something. I'm like, well, let me use a simple view real quick, and I'm going to hop inside of the text view and just use that as a sample. And then I pulled up the source code for text view. And then what I didn't realize, and most people don't realize, is that the text view class in Android is nearly 10,000 lines long.
10,000 lines? Holy cow, I didn't know that.
It's almost 10,000 lines long. It's humongous. So as you could tell, it's most likely pretty complex. It's not a simple thing. So bringing Elliot on the show is going to be awesome. So we'd love to talk a little bit about why font rendering is complex. Now, Elliot, you had done this talk in DroidCon NYC. What made you get really into text views and kind of diving deep into them?
Yeah, that's a great question. So this is one that, like, you know, I think like most people, it's dealing with Android stuff, you know, or any type of SDK in general, you kind of take APIs for face value until something really bad happens. And then after that, you start kind of diving deeper and deeper to see what's going on. And this is exactly the same case I was in. I was doing an app for a customer while I was at Mutual Mobile, and we had some specs from the designers that we were trying to accomplish from a text perspective. And we kept getting this nasty out of memory exception that was happening when we tried to render emojis at a certain text size. And after looking into it a little bit more, I kind of, you know, like you said, you look at text view, you think it's kind of a harmless widget, and then you notice it's 10,000 lines long. And not only that, but there's so many other classes that are kind of playing into actually rendering and writing the text on screen. And so from there, I have, you know, thankfully reached out on Twitter to kind of get some more understanding around this. And the people at Google were kind of really receptive and kind of helped figure out exactly what was going on. And it turned out that there was just this weird memory kind of this caching size that, in essence, when the fonts are rendered, it can hit kind of a limit for how much is rendered on screen. And so from there, I just started kind of going down in the deep end. I wanted to understand more of what was going on, which was just kind of intriguing to me as I kept going.
Interesting. And I know in your talk, you made reference to like a Medium post that Romain Guy wrote about font rendering specifically, right? So we'll obviously add a link to that in the show notes here. But can you talk a little more about it? Like, what was your general learning from there?
Yeah, I was thankful that Romain had just posted this, like maybe a month after I had run into this issue, and so it was nice because, you know, the minute that you actually kind of look behind the veil of the text view, you realize how complicated it is. And his post is just fantastic at giving you a really good working knowledge of what's going on behind everything, you know, because there's a lot of stuff that's going on. Like the people who work at Google to make text view work and to draw text on screen, these people have PhDs in actual, like, you know, text, writing text on computers and how computers render text. It's pretty ridiculous. So it's obvious that, you know, you may not necessarily need a PhD for this stuff, but like for certain, this is something that is pretty deep. So his post is fantastic to just get a base understanding of what's going on from, you know, GPU to what's going on when you're doing software rendering. It's pretty awesome.
The other challenge is also like a lot of these terms are like design specific terms, I imagine, right? Like just like types and fonts and that kind of stuff. So how did you manage dealing with that? I mean, is that also like a trouble? So as someone who is not necessarily a designer on a daily basis, if I dove into that, how easy or difficult would that be?
Yeah, I think, you know, there's stuff that just not even being in CS or not being a developer, not being involved with it, there's stuff that you're I guess just general education may have kind of pointed back to, but you know, for me, it was really difficult. I mean, I knew somewhat of what these things were just off of, you know, kind of learning the English language, and, you know, as a kid, learning how people wrote books and stuff like that prior to computers. But it's interesting that we're still kind of using that kind of language to discuss how we draw stuff on screen. So for sure, it takes a little bit of time to truly understand all the things that you need to know about how designers and how people, when they talk about typography, how they are communicating the things that are happening in a specific font or a typeface. It's definitely not easy.
Interesting. Can you give us like an example of like a term that's used that wouldn't necessarily be very straightforward for someone like me?
Yeah. So like, for instance, one of the ones that I think it sounds pretty straightforward, but kind of becomes a little bit more awkward in non-Latin based languages is things like ascenders and descenders. So an ascender, a descender it sounds very straightforward. It's the concept of, you know, a piece of a letter of text that is basically going to go above or below this baseline for a text. But, you know, where Android considers things to be ascending or descending is much different than where actual, you know, kind of typographers, people who are involved with type, they have a different way of actually defining that, which is really strange. So stuff like that can be very tricky, especially when you're looking at it from an Android perspective.
Would those be like the letter G and the letter P and things that go above and below the baseline of the text? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, so exactly. The ascenders and descenders would be like letters that have things that come off of them that go kind of, there's a description for each character, each letter that's kind of the normal size of the letter. So like a lowercase a is kind of one that would fill up an entire character space. And then like you're calling out, Don, G has the kind of tail on the end of it, which goes below the baseline for the letter, and that's considered a descender. And those are the things that in Latin languages are pretty easy to figure out. But then it's like you get into languages like Thai, where you can have multiple ascenders and descenders, and they can go on top of each other. It becomes very difficult.
So where did you find the majority of regarding ascenders and descenders? Where and how have you seen this affect Android developers the most? And what things do you think they should look out for?
I think anytime you go through localization, you'll find a lot of times, especially if you haven't thought about it up front, where you get kind of burned by these. And ascenders and descenders, mostly I've gotten burned with when I'm changing the line heights in my text views. I think, you know, and initially having kind of the initial value of line height is something that, you know, a lot of designers try to change in order to make the visual communication look better and the design to look better. And you do that thinking, okay, everything's great. And then you go to, you know, a language like Thai, like I was saying, or maybe Spanish, and you'll very quickly realize that all of your ascenders and descenders from lines are now on top of each other, and it makes the text completely illegible. So I think that's the initial place you'll probably find a lot of your problems.
I love how in your talk, one of the talking points was like how you can troll people. And someone actually did this in the previous versions of Instagram. And I guess we'll touch that a little later if we get time. Essentially, you can just completely troll your way through all the comments by using it was the Thai keypad, right?
Yeah, it was definitely Thai. It was a combination of having Thai and using one text view, which is, you know, obviously definitely a more performant solution with a bunch of using spans to kind of help change the design of your text with that one text view.
These trolls, man, they are super intelligent. We should just like hire them to be Android developers. Also, yeah, with the ascenders, descenders thing, Don, your name O has an umlaut, right? Like the German.
What? What'd you call me?
Every time I have to do like some design and use your name, it's like a standard thing.
Oh, I have no
it's
idea.
It's easy to test out, like Don O with an umlaut. All right. So, Elliot, in your talk, there's this excellent slide where you break it down really well. So, essentially, you say that there are three main packages that typically, as Android developers dealing with text and text views, that we have to worry about. Can you like quickly run us through those three packages and basically how they're categorized?
For sure. Yeah. So the first one that I always like to talk about is the one that we all know about, and that's the one that's fairly harmless to us because we always just take it for face value, and that's the text view, which is in the widget package. I mean, everyone knows this. It's fairly easy to kind of ask any Android developer. They're pretty keen on saying they know what the text view is. It gets a little bit more complex, and by that I mean actually a lot more complex when you go one layer down and find that the text view is actually using a package in Android.txt that is basically using layouts and text paint, and there's a bunch of other classes. There's like 20-something other classes that are in the Android text package that are being used. And then finally after that, there's the last one, which is graphics. So the best way I can kind of break everything down is that you've got the widget, which is consumed by your developers and is a great place for kind of doing all of the kind of being the one-stop shop for everything text view. Then when you get in the text package, you're dealing more with actually trying to figure out how we want to draw the text on the screen, how we want to define the fonts for the text as far as like the paint's concerned. And then the last being graphics is actually drawing the text on the screen. So it's broken into a pretty, I think it makes sense. It's definitely easy to grasp, but it just is such a huge kind of, not kludge, I don't want to say kludge, but it's a pretty deep thing to go into.
I get the graphics package and like the Canvas stuff because that makes sense, because we have dealt with that before, and that's like super low level where essentially you're like, forget all the widgets. I'll just like go old school and like render this thing directly on my own. But what are some of like the components in the text package that we would use? And as I understand, typically as an Android developer, almost 70 to 80% of the time, I wouldn't have to deal with these packages directly, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of times, so to kind of go back and answer the first one, a lot of the classes that you're looking at in the text package kind of range from different things. Like think of the text package as how Android figures out how to handle most of the problems or most of the things you're going to try to do in text for Android itself. The view, like I said, is the kind of first place that we, the first point of entry of actually getting the text on the screen. So it kind of acts as a coordinator of all the classes together. But, you know, some of the things you can look to find in there are things like static layout. So static layout is a class that allows you to basically figure out how much text is, or where the text is actually going to be put on the screen and how it's going to be laid out. So things like that, like you said, are not going to be used directly by developers for, you know, 99% of your use cases. There have been some people that have actually gone to using some of these actual elements and kind of subclassing, not even text view, but view, and then holding on to some of these things to help, you know, get some small performance increases. But yeah, so there's things like that. And then it's really weird. You go from having stuff like layout to having the HTML class, which is, you know, basically processing HTML strings to make it displayable for Android. So it's kind of hard. I think we could do an entire podcast just talking through the text package, and that would probably be super boring for everybody. But it is that large. It's pretty cool.
It's interesting. A fun little tidbit for the Android.txt package. There's actually a class in there called Boring Layout.
So, yeah, that's really, I remember that.
It's a fun little tidbit.
I always love that one. Kind of makes me laugh.
I heard this from basically your talk at DroidCon is with Wear, Android Wear apps, essentially you don't get text views, like you don't get the convenience of text views and all those higher level widgets, at least to my understanding yet. So it's all like you have to deal mostly with Canvas. Is that right? Or no, do you actually get text views, but it's just not performant?
Yeah, you're complete, at least as far as I know, there's still no support for the Android view system in Wear projects. So, and it's totally something that you end up having to kind of roll yourself. Thankfully, most of the stuff that the text view itself does, you could do and then potentially retrieve and then paint, draw on the canvas yourself. But yeah, it definitely is a little bit harder to get all of the kind of free stuff that you get with text view when you're making Wear apps.
So speaking of, you know, writing directly to a canvas, I can imagine that you're probably going to do a bunch of things possibly wrong when you do that, because it's not a familiar territory to most developers. I noticed they a performance problem that we had had when we were at, when I was at MyFitnessPal, and actually with a current colleague of yours, Eric Burke, who is on the Mind at MyFitnessPal, we were writing a basically an auto scalable text view. And we started knowing that when we would call set text on it, we had this really weird performance impact. So we're doing some weird recursion stuff. Have you experienced these type of performance rendering issues? Are there known issues in rendering text or anything like that? Or can you give us any information on it?
Yeah, so for sure, there definitely seems to be some stuff that maybe not necessarily issues from a normal use case, but like you said, when you're kind of adding in these weird edge cases or doing stuff that's very specific to like a business concern and you're wanting to do things like you said, like auto scale text, you can definitely get bitten by some of the things that are going on inside of the text view. The one that I can think of specifically is, you know, set text and the performance implications of what that means. A lot of times, if you look kind of under the hood of what's going on in set text, there's actually a lot of stuff that's similar to what's happening in the on draw, where it's actually laying, it's trying to figure out the layout. It's going to invalidate itself if it needs to. There's a lot of things that happen with the view that can go on when you're setting text, which is, it seems pretty harmless at the time. But like you said, when you have large text views, there are lots of text views that you're trying to update simultaneously or doing things like scaling, changing the size of the view itself, it can definitely burn you pretty quickly.
If you also have these text views inside of like something like a list view and perhaps a drawing and the text measurements taking up a lot of time, you know, this could actually kind of have a detrimental effect on your app. You know, please correct me if I'm wrong, because I believe all this happens on the UI thread, you know, the text rendering. Is that correct?
Yeah, from what I've been able to tell, it seems like that is the case. You know, there's obviously ways of kind of potentially trying to mitigate a lot of those things. And I think this is where some people will try to, you know, do things like hold a static layout to a text view you've already drawn and potentially reuse that so you don't have to go through redraw or kind of relaying out all that text if you already know where it's going to go. But yeah, that's one of the things that I've never also used with text views is adding drawables inside of them. There obviously may be some really amazing things with that, but I think that anytime you try to add those kind of things, it's just, it becomes very kludgy and performance will definitely take a hit.
So speaking of performance, when you do have these crazy performance issues, how do you end up measuring the performance impact? Is there any tools you can use or what are the tips and tricks you might use?
Yeah, thankfully we have TraceView, which is, I think, you know, probably one of the best tools right now. So TraceView has been around for a while. I think they included it built in and the like one the beta version of Android Studio, but they had it available prior to that, and I forgot when it was when the inception of it was. But in essence, TraceView is going to be your kind of best bet for diagnosing any of those issues. It's going to give you basically really good understanding of what all is going on inside of your layouts and what's actually happening to the VM itself when you're drawing stuff on the screen. So I think that's probably my favorite one. Another one that's really awesome to use that you can do quickly is just on the device is actually enabling the GPU profiling on your from your developer options. I think that one's really great because then you can see kind of the lag or the stuff that's going on that when you're loading your apps and when you're going from screen to screen. That's been one that I've been able to pinpoint tons of UI issues in our apps all over the place just from having that on. And that's very quick. You don't even need to be next to your computer to kind of capture some of that information, which is cool.
Yeah, that's actually a fantastic tip. And even in many cases, you can sort of like detect from other applications. You can just like turn it on and then start using other applications and immediately you can start to see like the differences that are there or the optimizations that they could potentially make. I remember reading this in a previous post. This is like from the folks at Instagram. So they actually have a very nice post where they talk about how they specifically improved like the comment rendering on their Android application. And we'll obviously point folks to that. But to quickly give a gist, you mentioned about this static layout and dynamic layout trick that is used. And that's basically one of the things. In text view, like there are like a gazillion things that happen in the background, and the views that come shipped by default with Android, while they're super useful, for example, like relative layout, grid layout, linear layout, all these things, while they're super useful, they have to account for a gazillion cases because this is going to be used in all sizes of devices and across all countries. And there's a whole bunch of things that happen in the background in order to make sure that that simple text view actually does like a whole bunch of things, right? So one strategy that they recommend, and you alluded to this earlier, Elliot, is so you can use a custom text view, which extends this thing called like a layout, right?
Yeah. So, and I think the one that you're describing in their case, I think, you know, they had already gone down the path of using text view and found that they were getting burned by this. And so what ended up being the solution for them was to make a text, their own text layout view that extends just view. It doesn't extend text view. And they would programmatically set the layout after they had rendered the first text view. And then that way they would they could do the layout themselves and hold on to it, and so that when draw happens, they just have to draw. They don't have to do anything that's going to be, you know, super complex or is going to be, you know, resource intensive in the on draw, which is, I mean, if you go look at the text view on draw, it's something like 80 to 100 lines itself. It's pretty brutal. It's doing a lot of stuff. And like you said, it's definitely more general purpose and has to cover every corner case. The one thing I'd have to say, though, is I agree with you that sometimes you make your own custom stuff. But the one thing I'm hesitant about saying that everyone should go out and do that is because of some of the things you do get for free, which are really helpful, which is like right to left support and some of the things that help with your localization and stuff like that. That's, you know, I think this is definitely not a wrong approach that the Instagram team is doing. This is a really cool thing. I want to see more of how this works. I actually kind of want to try it myself, but I always am like cautious of jumping into that stuff first.
Yeah.
So Instagram has this post, and I'll actually add a link to both the original post. The funny thing is they don't necessarily give their solution to how they actually do it. But in a silver spoon, there's this Stack Overflow post that precisely shows how Instagram does this. So we'll add a link to that in the show notes. There's also another link that I'll add, which is super cool. And this is about Apple Music. So essentially, they have a music app. Apple actually has an Android app. Yes, that is true. And someone basically did a complete deep dive into this, and essentially they've found out like some of the energy glitches and the performance impacts that happen. And again, it boils down, and I'll actually add an excerpt here. So basically what they have said is the problem boiled down to essentially their text views, right? So the set text method was causing constantly, because the way it works is because they had a song playing and like the timestamp kept changing as like the song proceeded, as the song elapsed time and like the remaining time kind of kept changing, the text view had to, they use like a dynamic width text view, and so that kept redrawing, and that actually led to a performance impact. So it was crazy. They have like good metrics, and they compare different apps and how they do it. So I'll add a link to that in the show note.
That's pretty cool. Yeah, and I think, you know, another one, another kind of concern is sometimes not even performance, but I find a lot of times that I end up looking more into text views when I'm doing kind of things for localization. So like in a lot of cases, and I think a lot of developers may have be in the same boat. You know, the app is designed, we get the designs where, you know, hopefully if your company's using Zeppelin, awesome. You've got everything in your Zeppelin and you can go and start, you know, working on your screens. And then at some point, you're going to try to localize your app. And maybe that was my first kind of thought from the design perspective or product. And then all of a sudden, you get bitten by some of these issues we were talking about earlier with the ascenders and descender characters kind of overlapping and just having visual kind of cruft in your text views. So this is one of the places that I always find that I spend most of my time is coming back and trying to fix a lot of visual issues for localizations because we didn't think about localization in the first point. You know, it wasn't something that we did as a product or even as from an engineering perspective, making sure that we were kind of set up for that. So that's actually where I spend a lot more of my time dealing with text views and debugging text views.
Elliot, quick question. What exactly is the difference between internationalization and localization? Are they basically the same thing or do they point to the same thing?
Yeah, this is a great question. So if anybody from my company is listening, they're going to immediately know that the difference between localization and internationalization. I've been harping on this quite hard. And the reason is there is a difference between the two of them. Like internationalization is basically from the beginning, the inception of a product is designing it in a way that it will be easy to localize. And from that, you basically can kind of deduce that localization is the actual act of making something localized for a language. So like taking it and actually getting things to be set up so that if you're in, Spain and you speak Spanish, then you're going to see the app for Spain Spanish at locales. So internationalization is something that's done, definitely before engineering actually works on something. But the one thing I do want to call out in this is that it doesn't mean engineering shouldn't be involved. And you should try, if you're the lead engineer or if you're just the only engineer who cares, you should get yourself injected in those conversations as they're happening before, because it will save you lots of time to actually localize.
Now, when you're actually going through we're familiar with the resource qualifiers for localization. And for those that aren't, it's basically the language qualifier that's on the, certain folders and resources. Yeah, it's like values hyphen, ES for Spanish, or values hyphen FR for France and so forth. So you can create these different locales and different things inside of your resources. Now, I think the big question is, and I've done, help multiple applications go from one language to multiple languages and so forth. How is the best way to do this? Like, for example, I have mainly just always made sure I put my strings in the resource folder. I think that's a good start. But is there any type of, do you have any tips or tricks, or how do you normally support this or go about making sure that you implement internationalization, localization on an app, kind of from maybe even the ground up? Do you have any tips at all?
I know in your talk, you mentioned about Google's checklist for basically going forward with this kind of stuff like localization. There's also a very special one called the Elliott Changer Design Checklist. Can you talk more about that?
This is just because I am really horrible at naming things and I have no creativity when it comes to that stuff. So yes, my checklist, I really love what Google's done in creating that checklist for, it's not just for engineers, which is awesome. It's for everybody from business, design. But the thing is that it's very hard, I think, for engineers to discern what's actually actionable from an engineering standpoint. So like my checklist is actually pretty short and I could probably add a whole lot more stuff to it. But for the sake of time, I'll keep it short. My first one is definitely supporting right to left. You never know when you're going to need to support a language that involves right to left text. And Android, thankfully, in API 17 started giving us some more tools in the layouts and XML that we can use to help make it easier for us to actually support right to left, and which the text view handles itself, as we've kind of talked about previously. So I would definitely make sure that you support right to left. Make sure you have your manifest set up so that you can support right to left. If you don't have that in there, any work you do after this is just going to be for nothing. So make sure that, instead of using margins left and right for API 17 and above, use start and end. Android will intelligently know how to switch between which side of the screen it's supposed to be on, depending on the configuration of the user's device. I definitely, like I said, I would also localize my fonts. And when I say that, I mean localizing the actual place that we're grabbing the assets from. The reason why I say that is a lot of times, I think this is kind of another thing that from a design perspective, engineers probably miss out on, but different languages actually need to use different fonts because how those fonts are rendered in those cultures are kind of sometimes can be culturally, aggressive or just basically expressing the wrong things. So,
interesting. So what you're basically saying is even the font file that we have should be localized. So you would have like the name for the font be like, so you could potentially be using different like font files altogether for different locales?
Yeah, exactly. So like the one that I can think of that's like the easiest for people to go and check out is the difference between some of the Google fonts for Android. Now there's a concept of like, I think Noto Sans, and then there's another font file and I can't remember it off the top of my head, but in essence, yeah, there's a different font file for Roboto for like Latin-based languages than there is for for, you know, more of like Chinese and Mandarin and Japanese, like, you know, kanji and some of that stuff is all very different font files. So localizing that is actually a really helpful thing. It makes it easy to, you don't have to do the work of trying to figure out what language you're in or what locale you're in.
Guys, I have a solution for all of this. Fixed width fonts, like that's it.
Yes. Bam.
This is a solved problem.
Comic Sans, dude. I think I have the perfect, you said your naming was, you know, you weren't creative with your naming, but that's Elliot Changer's design checklist. So you could just call it ECDC.
I was thinking the exact same thing when he mentioned, like, you should go, yeah. When you have conversations with the people, you're like, oh, have you heard of ECDC?
Yeah.
You know, you should, when you say it with confidence, it sounds like a good name. So
now you should print some t-shirts, you know, like ACDC shirts, but just put the E there, you know, Thunderstruck. There you go.
All right. There we go. That's it. I'll have that up on Teespring here shortly.
You got like some design geniuses here.
I love it. This is fantastic.
So you mentioned like font file, localizing your font file. What are some of the other ones that you would like to touch?
Yeah, I'd say like one of the ones that I've actually seen a lot of times people using because, and I know this, I was one of the ones that did this at one point very early in my career, but is not using or not setting include font padding to false. And the reason why you shouldn't do this ever is because this actually removes extra padding that's put into the fonts so that you can properly render ascending and descending characters without causing issues between different multi-line text. And when you do this, it normally helps the visuals. It helps when you're kind of doing visual QA with designers. It helps bring the text to where it needs to be from kind of, you know, the pixel perfect standpoint. But it really does make it much harder for you to handle localization later on down the road. And you'll end up having to revert that, which means not a lot of happy designers. And the visually, it could break things. So I definitely would say not to do that. And one of the things actually that I didn't point out in my talk, but is super relevant, is I know a lot of times, you know, because we're getting stuff from Zeppelin or red lines from things, a lot of times people may notice, and I've actually had discussions with some of our designers at Under Armour about this, you know, you'll notice that the text, the actual box that the text is rendered in from Zeppelin and from a lot of design tools, it's not measuring that. They're normally measuring at very like specific places of where the text is actually like filling up the space in the view. So, and what I mean by this is like there's either extra room or when they're actually doing red lines, they think the edges of the text are very true to form. So, right, like if you have a lowercase g, designer may redline and say that if you're trying to, you know, have margins below that text, they may think that the text view is going to render right to the edge of that G. And I a lot of times have to tell them to not be very like specific with that stuff because Android adds more pixels in between the lines. So chances are what you're seeing in red lines is not actually how Android's going to render it. So I always try to make sure and call that out because it ends up being something that comes up a lot in our visual QA.
So, and just to quickly backtrack a second, you mentioned Zeppelin. For those of us who don't know what Zeppelin is basically like I think it's just a web app, right? I'm not sure if they have a native application, but it just makes it easy to deal with designers. So essentially sharing resources and a whole bunch of things, right?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. It's definitely making it easy to share resources, easy for, it's just helping the gap between getting stuff to engineers.
Interesting. We use this tool called RedPen at Instacart, which I imagine is similar, but I got to have a look at Zeppelin as well. Looks interesting.
Yeah, one of the things that I love about Zeppelin, so one of my buddies, Matt Ware, who's actually works at HomeAway here in Austin, he did a great talk at Big Android Barbecue about Sketch. And so Zeppelin, for everyone who doesn't know, Zeppelin is a tool that's kind of an in-between between Sketch and us as engineers in Android Studio. And it's one of those things that's actually, you know, pretty inexpensive. I suggest most people actually go and try Sketch. And if not, if they like it, you know, purchase it. Even as an engineer, it's really, really interesting to see how designers work. And it helps your day-to-day, especially if you're having to make small changes to assets. I actually find that I'm able to do that without having to kind of bother designers, just make small changes. But go check out Matt's his Sketch talk. It's definitely great, like get your feet wet for Sketch, but I love both of those tools.
Oh, fantastic. We'll add a link to that in the show notes. Sketch is basically the cool kids in the design world today are using for like using it as a Photoshop equivalent, but I believe it's built more for today's world versus Photoshop, which is quite antiquated at this point, right?
Correct.
Yeah, I spend a large majority of my time inside of Sketch and inside of the Zeppelin native component as well. I'm in there all day long. It's great.
Awesome. So, Elliot, thank you so much. This was all a lot of fun stuff to talk about.
If
our listeners want to reach out to you, what's a good way to do that?
Yeah, so two different places. Twitter, my handle is echenger, C-H-E-N-G-E-R. And then I've got a website that I blog sometimes on called omitneedlesscode.com.
Omitneedlesscode. Love it. All right. So if folks want to find out more, this episode, I think, is going to have like a chock full of show notes. There's going to be some interesting links. If you want to find those links, fragmentedpodcast.com/episodes/39. That's the link that you want to go and check. If you have feedback or suggestions for us, as always, Fragmented Cast is the Twitter handle that both Don and I use.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want to complain to Don specifically, directly, Don, mm-hmm. how do they do that?
It's at Kaushik Gopal. My Twitter handle is at Don Felker, or you can reach me at my website at donfelker.com.
Perfect. And if you have good things to say, then Kaushik Gopal is the Twitter handle that you want to be tweeting at. We're just kidding. We like all kinds of feedback, as Don has mentioned in previous episodes. It's the feedback that keeps us going and also helps us understand how we can improve the show. So thanks for all of that.
Thank you,
Elliot,
so much. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Before we wrap this bad boy up, I want to go ahead and thank The Nerdery. The Nerdery is always looking for iOS, Android, and mobile app designers who will thrive in its creative, collaborative environment. Aspiring nerds and applicants can learn more at nerderyjobs.com/fragmented. Now, don't forget, that's a special URL. There's no E's in nerderyjobs.com. So it's nerdryjobs.com/fragmented. If you can't write it down, just go ahead and open up the little notes tab on your podcast app and tap the link in the show notes, and it'll take you right to where you need to be. Again, thanks for sponsoring the episode, Nerdery.
This has been an amazing episode. We will catch you next week.